Open your Bibles to John chapter 15. John chapter 15, we'll start at verses 9 and read down to 13. Who's speaking here?
Jesus.
Verse 9 says, as the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. Verse 11, these things I have spoken to you that my, what?
Joy.
That my joy may remain in you and that your joy may be full. Verse 12, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. Is there joy in the Christian journey?
Yes.
There should be, right? Jesus said that if we abide in him, if we do what he says, then his joy will be in us, and our joy will be what? This joy that he's talking about, it's not like the joy and the pleasure that the world gives, okay? You know that feeling when you go out and buy a new car or a new motorcycle?
It's been a while.
That's about 12-hour joy.
But when you do that, you're happy, right? Until that first payment comes in, then you go, what the have I done? But that joy doesn't last, right?
Amen.
How many of you guys remember buying a home and the joy that you get when you buy the new home and all the possibilities that come with it of decorating it and making it the way you want? But even that doesn't last, because once you've made in payments for so long, it's not new anymore, right? And it's just, this is just my home. But the joy that Jesus gives can be, should be, new every day.
Amen.
Because what Jesus gives, number one, if you get to wake up tomorrow, it's a brand new day. And he has promised to never leave you and never forsake you. And that no matter what that day brings to you, whether good, whether bad, or whether somewhere in between, his love, his joy, his peace cannot be shaken in the believer. Amen?
Amen.
The title of this message today is Join the Journey. How can there be joy? Now, let me rephrase this. Why did Jesus say, if you love me, keep my commandments? And then he talked about his joy being in you. Why did he link the two? Because today, in most Protestant churches, there's been a stepping away from doctrine or keeping commandments and rules. But Jesus makes it plain right here that for joy, for real Christian joy, it's linked with obedience. Is that right? How many of you guys remember having children? Right? How many of you guys remember when those kids were about 13? And that stage in your life? So listen, do you remember being new parents when you brought the baby home and you're wondering, am I ever going to get to sleep again? And that stage passes, right? Then they're like 3, 4, 5, 6, it's a beautiful age because they look up to you. You know what I'm saying? And you're like their world. You tell them things, they listen to you. Everything you say is right, correct. They don't actually question you. But a switch flips at like 12 and 13 and 14. And you're wondering, where did that child go? And who is this? I want you to think about this. Think about this in our relationship with God. Jesus said, if you love me, what? Now, what you gotta love about Christ is that he links his commandment keeping with love. love for him and love for his people. And that love is the fulfillment of the law. Is that right? So listen, when you were dealing with your teenage child, and you know, ground rules change at that age, and apparently they don't like any type of rule. Okay? What I've experienced from being at that age, to being a parent of somebody that age, to being a Christian following God, is that there's not much difference between me and my walk with God and that teenager there. Because God has rules, and I don't like rules. But what I found is that it's this flesh that doesn't like rules.
Amen.
But when I gave my heart to Jesus Christ, and I was born again, and now I have Christ's Spirit living in me, I got to see that these weren't so much rules as they were telling me how I can please my Father and my Savior. And as I grew to love Jesus Christ and realizing when he said to his disciples, if you have seen me, you've seen the Father, I wanted to make him happy. I wanted to show him love that I'm able to have because of the love that he has shown me. And what I found is that that's tied into these Ten Commandments. That if I truly love God, I'm not going to have any other gods before him. Does that make sense to you guys? Right? That if I really loved him, I'm not going to put anything else in that spot. That God will have the priority of my heart, of my affections, and of my mind. That I'm not going to bow down to any images or anything and think that's a god. We live in America, we don't do that today. I've had plenty of friends that did that with their cars. They treated their cars better than they treated their families. And I realize that's a form of idolatry. That's a form of bowing down. And as I started to mature in Christ, I started to see these things and realize that if I love God, I'm not going to do that. And you can go through all 10 of them and realize that, listen, if I truly love God, then I'm not going to lie to my brothers and sisters. Is that right? Because it's not showing them love. If I don't show them love, I'm not showing God love. It's all linked and tied together. In the process of learning all of this, I started to glimpse, not fully understand, but glimpse what joy in Christ is and can be. Because all of us who have lived as adults for any number of years, you realize that life is not always pleasant. Life is not always joyful. There are some good times, but there are also some really bad times. What you find out is the older you get, the more intense those bad things can be. Some of us are dealing with our elderly parents, and we're wondering, how did we ever get to this stage this quickly? And what you need to realize is that's the next stage that you're going to be facing. Because that's life. Through 54 years of living in this earth, I've come to know for a fact that God's word is true, that when he makes a promise, he will hold true to that promise. But I also know that if there's ever been a problem with me understanding God, it's not on God's part, it's always been on my part. And that is either immaturity, a lack of understanding of his word. Now listen, this is one of the things that really helped me fall in love with Jesus Christ. And that as Christ was able to take me as a babe in Christ and love me there and also help me to mature in Christ, and that's not an easy process. Yeah. I told you before that we are like onions, okay? Onions have many what?
Layers.
Many layers. It's a babe in Christ. You're just dealing with that outer layer. And you're thinking, man, God's working on me. This is a great thing. But what you don't realize is there are so many other layers that God is going to continue to work on. Is that right, Ray?
Amen.
And when God deals with one layer, and he starts dealing with the next layer, he starts dealing with the next layer, God is faithful in completing the work that he started when you first gave your heart to him. So I tell you that to realize, or for you to realize that, number one, always have joy in your walk with Jesus Christ. Because what the devil is going to try to do is take that joy away from you. And he's going to throw numerous things in your path. Whether they're temptations to sin and separate yourself from God, or whether there are temptations to doubt and still separate yourself from God. That's what the devil's design is. But Jesus said, I will never leave you and never forsake you. And that if he lives inside of you through the power of his Holy Spirit, then you can go through whatever this life throws at you and still have joy.
Amen.
Turn with me to Romans chapter 14. Let's look at verse 17. Romans 14, verse 17. Verse 17 says, for the kingdom of God is not eating and drinking, but what is the kingdom of God? It's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Now listen, doesn't that sound like good news?
Amen.
Doesn't that sound like something that we would want to seek after day by day by day? That the kingdom of God is joy, it's peace. It's also power and victory that's found in the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says that he who is in you is greater than what? He that is in the world. What does that actually mean? If God is for you, who can be against you? That's easy to say, I understand that when things are going well. But when you're in the midst of a valley, sorrow and of pain, sometimes that's hard to see. But listen, God will never leave you. And even through that time, God draws even closer to you through that time to support you, to show you his love, and to let you know that you're not alone.
Amen.
Turn to Acts chapter 13. Acts chapter 13, we're going to be looking at verses 49 through 52. Okay, Acts chapter 13, verses 49, it says, and the word of the Lord was being what?
Spread.
Was being spread throughout all the region. This means that Christ's followers, Christ's disciples, were sharing Jesus Christ. And the word was moving forward with power, and people were accepting Christ as their Lord and Savior. And mighty things were being done. Doesn't that sound good?
Yeah.
Listen, you need to listen and read that next verse. Because once you start advancing the kingdom of God, Satan is not going to sit still. You guys understand that? Right? Verse 50, but the Jews stirred up the devout and prominent women and the chief men of the city, raised up persecution against Paul and Barnabas and expelled them from their region. But what did those guys do? Verse 51. But listen, this needs to be our attitude and our frame of mind. But this can only happen if you really know Jesus Christ. And if you really allow the Holy Spirit to work in you. Now listen, Can you name any other Bible character outside of Jesus Christ who suffered more than Paul? How would you like God to say about you, I'm going to make him my follower and I'm going to show him what great things he's going to suffer for my kingdom? Okay? Wasn't that what God said about Paul?
Yeah.
And did Paul say, Lord, why don't you find somebody else? Why do you think Paul, do you know what that word constrained? Constrained means?
Yeah. Can't do anything else?
Now we went and did, we read this verse in my Sabbath school class. For the love of Christ constraineth me. What does that mean?
Hold you fast?
Does it push you forward? It's not restrained. Constrained. I always got those two words mixed up. Now, what did Paul do? Paul suffered. Did he say, Lord, isn't it time for me to retire yet? Or did he say, let's go to this city. Let's go back and visit this church. Let's go and move forward the gospel of Jesus Christ. Nothing ever stopped him. Why? Because he had the love of Christ in his heart and the power of the Holy Spirit that showed him that it doesn't matter what your outside circumstances are. You could be in a dungeon. You could be being whipped. You could be lying in the street after you were stoned. But if you know that God has never left you and God's love is always with you, then it gives you the power to continue to move forward with joy. And you remember the story when him and his partner were beaten and they were thrown into the middle of the jail? What did they do? They sang and praised God. Now I hit my finger with a hammer. And I got to tell you, I did not sing and did not praise God. And that was only one hit. This was a long time ago, in case you're wondering. Okay. When I look at the life of Paul, I start to see and understand what it really means to have Christ truly living in my heart. That there's nothing that this world can do to me that can take away that joy. So should there be joy in the journey of the Christian?
Yes.
The question is do you have that joy in your day-to-day lives? Verse 51 says, after they were expelled from the city in the region, they shook off the dust from their feet against them, and they went to another place called Iconium. Okay? Verse 52, and the disciples were filled with what?
Joy.
They were filled with joy and the Holy Spirit. Okay? You cannot have godly joy unless you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. Okay? And so without that, what you will try to find is joy is what the world offers you, whether it's in things or people. Things get old very quickly and people will always let you down. Okay? But finding your joy in Christ through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit will allow you to be thrown out of this city and joyfully going into the next city. That's what Christ does for us. That's why we should have joy. And that's what the world is looking for in Christ's followers. But listen now. Do you believe that we're living in the last days?
Yes.
Do you believe that the deceptive power of Satan is working in a mighty way today?
Yes.
I have been to church services where they try to manufacture that joy and that excitement, whether it's through styles of music, whether it's through styles of preaching. That is not what God has called us for. And this is one of the reasons why God has raised this church up, and it is to show biblical worship and biblical truth in that worship. Yeah. I've had people come and go, man, your church service is boring. But listen, there's something about the beauty of holiness that doesn't need electric instruments, screaming and yelling, and a spirit that's not from God, but excites the people. You understand what I'm saying? What God has called us to do is to worship Him in a manner that's actually pleasing to Him, and that will allow the Holy Spirit to fill His people. Then you will experience true joy, true worship, and true closeness to God. Unfortunately, today, a lot of that's just manufactured. I can remember when I first joined the church back in the early 80s. And in the Protestant church, this movement was going on about, if you want to keep your kids, then you need to gear your worship services to them. And I remember that this one pastor started off by telling stories. And then that got old to the kids. And then he started actually bringing in props to help tell his stories. Got to the point where the guy actually took a bungee cord and jumped off one of the rafters in the ceilings so that he could keep the kids' attention. Is that what God has called us to do? Listen. If the Word of God alone is not enough to inspire God's people, the problem isn't with the Word.
Amen.
The problem is with... Okay? Joy in the journey. So turn with me to Galatians chapter 5. Gary, do you have your tablet?
Mm-hmm.
Can you turn that on for me and bring it to me?
Sure.
Galatians chapter 5. And we want to look at verse 22. Galatians 5, verse 22 says what? But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, 23, gentleness, self-control, and against such there is what?
No.
Do you realize that the most prescribed and taken drug in America are antidepressants? Is there a lack of joy in our culture? Is there a lack of joy in this world? Now listen, as Christians, we should have joy.
Amen.
Right? But I gotta tell you, I gotta be honest with you, a lot of Christians that I meet don't have joy. I meet a lot of Christians that are worriers, and they worry. My grandmother used to be a worrier. If there was an Olympic event for worrying, she'd win the gold. Apparently that's hereditary, because the older my mother got, she fell into those same lines. Christ tells us to cast all of our cares upon Him. Why? Because He cares. That we do not need to allow anxiety to rule us, but that we can have joy and peace. What does that word long-suffering mean? Patience, right? Patience. In the 25, 26, 27, 28, almost 30 years of walking with Christ, that one word, that patience, is still the biggest thing. And it got to the point where I'm afraid to ask God for patience, because it would work well if God had a magic wand and said, bink, you got patience. God doesn't work that way. Okay, so if you need patience, how is God going to actually work in your life to make you stronger in that area? Okay, so I'm not alone in coming to that conclusion, right? But listen, is it needed? Is it important? When you look at the history of the early church in the book of Acts, and you realize all that they endured and all that they suffered, but the joy and the peace and the happiness that they had, and you realize that they truly manifested patience and long-suffering. What always draws me to my knees and back to the cross of Christ is realizing how patient God has been with me. And realizing that if God can be patient with me, He can be patient with anybody.
Amen.
And if He manifests that love and that patience towards me, then I am convinced that God will do it for everybody. If we ask, if we seek, and if we allow the Spirit to work in our lives. So listen, is God's word true or is it false?
True.
So why don't we see more of the fruit of the Spirit within God's people? This joy, this peace. I'd be happy with just those two. You know what I'm saying? True joy, true peace. The joy I'm talking about is a joy that is not, like I said, influenced by what's going on in your life. You understand what I'm saying? How many of you ever ran a business? Okay, so you know the stresses of running a business. You know that you could have a day that starts out really good and then that can turn south really quick. The problem with owning your own business is there's nobody else to shift all that responsibility to. Once it starts going downhill, you're it. Right, Ray?
Yeah.
And what you find out is this slide can just keep going, and you're wondering, is there an end to this? And you find out, no, this is where patience and long-suffering come in. Okay? And you're thinking, okay, I made it through this day, but you find out the next day is going to be the same thing. I want the joy that gets me through that and doesn't affect the peace and the love and the joy that I have in Christ. What I found is that if I am actually focused and aware and keep my mind on Christ, He will do that for me. But if I allow the circumstance to overwhelm me and now I'm acting in my own power, trying to figure out what I'm going to do to take care of the situation, it usually does not work out. So again, what I've learned in my own experience is maturity in Christ comes only through abiding in Christ. Sounds simple. But how many of you start your day with prayer and within 15 minutes of being at work forget what it is you actually prayed for? Because of whatever situation goes on. Okay? But what I've learned personally is that if I keep my mind and my spiritual eye stayed on Christ, Christ will help me through all of that. Gary?
If we can realize that there's nothing we can do, that we're totally dependent on God in every situation, that makes a difference to me anyway.
See, and that's what the early followers of Christ in the early church had. They had a full dependence on Christ. He was their all in all. Now you find stories where, like, Peter was in jail, they're praying for his release. Peter gets released and knocks on the door. They're in the middle of a prayer meeting to get him out of jail, and they don't believe he's actually out of jail. Same? But God still used them because they still trusted. What was it when the disciples were brought before the Sanhedrin, the same ones that condemned Christ to death? What was their prayer when they were let go? The Sanhedrin told them, don't preach in this name anymore. What did they go back and pray for? Boldness to preach in that name, right? That's what we need to realize, that God wants to do a mighty work in us if we only believe that He can do it in us. And if we would approach Him, right?
If we're living, moving in the Spirit, as is the verse that you've read, we have arms. There's nothing manufactured here by me.
Because it all comes from Him. It's all through Him.
Right.
All we are the vessels, right? The vessels that He indwells.
So if I'm 20 minutes away from my prayer, as you say, and I'm driving down the road mad at my brother because he's driving like an idiot, okay? That's his car. It's got nothing to do with me. I don't have patience, then I'm not in the Spirit.
Exactly.
I'm not in the Spirit.
This is what Paul talks about over and over again in the book of Romans about being in Christ. That needs to not just be a day-to-day thing. That needs to be a second-by-second lifestyle that we're in Christ. Listen, there's... Turn me to...